you for coming, although there is a wonderful sun outside and you could be at the beach. But it's for me a great honor to come again here. I was present last year in this conference, and at the time I presented two specific projects to do with our approach to sustainability, although I don't like much this word because I think it's much more a complex issue, sustainability nowadays. And I presented last year two projects that I think are key for our way of seeing the sustainable design. This year, Marina asked me to instead giving our great loss from, it's about 2 months now that Jean passed away, to show you some of the project of the practice and tell you a bit about what Jean did for all of us as architects and the way forward for our office as well. So Jean was a very complex woman. She was, for all of the people that knew her personally, a very complex human being. She was strong and fragile at the same time. She was, as somebody said, romantic and a warrior at the same time. Many people think that somehow the way that her architecture shows in built buildings shows a very, very powerful human being. But I can assure you she was always, always putting her design and criticizing her design to a way to make it better. Personally, I think as an architect of this generation, we all own her a lot, and to her and to the practice, to the way she opened new ways of thinking about the space and the built environment. So we, in today's presentation, I will start with somehow tell you about Jean's progression in her career. But then I want to give you an overview of different projects, small and big scale, and the approach to design that she has taught to us, part of her office, but to everyone. A lot of things that were considered only as dreams of very creative architects have become reality, built buildings. And this is what I want to show you. I want to show you the process, I want to show you the thinking, I want to show you how much we all own her in terms of our creative process to Jean and to the practice. I just choose some of the picture of Jean. I think she was a beauty in herself. I mean, she was a person that emanated a lot of energy and passion. She devoted her life to architecture. Since she was a little girl, as you can see here in these images, she had this idea of having to reinvent the living space of her apartment back in Baghdad. And she was lucky because the parents said, okay, you can do whatever you want. And she designed a range of furniture and the flooring and so on. She was just a kid. And she already knew that this would have been her profession. Jean studied mathematics and she studied architecture at the Architectural Association in London, where she moved when she was still a student. And at the time, the faculty was a very open platform for architects to express themselves. And I think Jean's contribution also to the teaching and to the way this faculty have been developing through the years has been fantastic. Jean had been always working, apart from a short time that she worked for with OMA, she always had her own practice, and for 20 years she wasn't able to build anything. She was doing projects and projects and projects, and nothing was ever coming to become a real product of her work. Though all of those experiments of the first year of her life, they finally, at the end of the 90s, become a lot of interesting and new ideas in buildings. So yeah, I mean, this This is a bit of a tradition for us. I mean, every time we have an opening for one of our projects, we do bake. I mean, we're not us, but we ask to a bakery to have a gigantic cake that is in the shape of the building. And I mean, this year we celebrated with Zara. She was really into parties, really open with people. And we had two fantastic parties. One was for her birthday party, and the other one that she recently won the gold medal. It was just a month before passing away. A very overdue recognition of her career. She had been the first woman in the history of this medal to win it in her own good. All of the others were kind of partners of somebody else. And in this sense, she was also a pioneer for all of us as female architects in a predominantly dominated male environment. But that was really also on this topic because, you know, I worked there for 12 years. I had two children while working at the office. She didn't care about male-female difference. She was though annoyed that many times because she was felt out of, you know, the club where you discuss big things and big projects, she couldn't even join because they're all male clubs. But she really believed in the fact that if you want and you really push yourself to the limit, you can get everywhere, despite being male or female. And this is, again, another important, I think, message that she has given to me and to the female generation of architects. It's not about who you are, it's about what you can do and how much passion you put into your work that makes the difference. So those are some of the exhibition of Zha at the EA. And already, I mean, at the time she was experimenting through big master planning project, through furniture design, and she experimented with herself as well. There was yesterday a discussion about clothing. Zara was really into fashion, and for her, the expression of what you are has to be part of also how you dress. Sometimes, like the dress she's wearing with the red background, sometimes, this is what she was wearing at the Riba Gold Medal, the dress was in the way. I mean, she had a little bit of a problem to do the presentation, but I mean, she really wanted to be a presence in the space throughout her image as well. Many people think that fashion is not part of the architect world. It's not true. I mean, our presence in a building, our way of moving through the building with our body changes the space. And somehow working and playing and have a true expression of what you are through clothes. I think it was something that she did very well. This is Zara in one of the student presentation in the States. Zara has been teaching for a very long time in many, many universities. And somehow we are all her students at the office. 80%, if we want to put a number, of her staff. It comes from having not only worked with her, but having been her student. And the effort she puts, she had been putting in teaching together with Patrick Schumacher, that is partner at the practice, had been really great. She was in Yale just before passing away to work with her students. So Zha has been traveling a lot, visiting all of her buildings under construction during the opening. She could gather a great, I mean, like a real star. I mean, everyone knows Zha from newspapers because she gets a big crowd of people all around her. But the interest in her person is because of what she did, because of what she achieved. Pritzker Prize, first one. She won the Imperial Japanese Medal, that is again something unseen before for a female architect. She won she became lady, and this is again something directly from the Queen. With Margaret Thatcher, who was explaining one of the projects that eventually didn't got built, with the Queen and so on, and with us. I think what is important to understand is that although Zara has been traveling a lot, her presence was with us when she was in London, but was a constant text messaging us and checking on our work, and the work that we pull together in the practice has to be seen as a truly collective effort. When the office became quite big during the years, I started and we were only 40 people, and now it's more close to 400 people, but it's still an atelier. We are still working in small groups, and the small group, they party together, but they also somehow really bring to life a lot of their, again, legacy. I mean, what she taught us as a student first, and then by working with her, is what shows in many of the projects that I'm gonna show you now. So, one of the topics that I want to touch first is this relation between some of our design, of Zadid Architect design, with the landscape. There was a lot of discussion yesterday about the relation between nature and built environment, and how those two elements can interact. And one of the things that Zara, I think, really works on is to try to bring some of the components or that makes us feel well in a natural environment back into the urban fabric. How we can, you know, fragment somehow and work with the human fabric to a way that it's more related to the way we are part of this universe. Fragmentation, working with geometry that are really not forced into a grid. I mean, there is nothing like a regular grid in nature. Though all our cities are kind of based on this idea of, you know, roads that cut across and way of really fragmenting bits and pieces of our building environment with no connection. Zara projects were looking at completely the opposite. The built environment, and this is a master plan built by the office, it's an old project but still valid. The design of the building is not ours. What is ours is the design of the master plan. And the idea of the fragments then and of the fragments being together and giving you a different grid, a grid that you can explore, is what you can see mostly in some of those projects. This is a master plan for an area in Turkey, a project in an area of low density in Beijing. But the idea, we don't have to shy off from big developments as well. I think it's quite easy when you have to design, you know, a pavilion, or you have to design a private house, to really look at this connection between nature and built environment. I think somehow the key problems of high density cities like Beijing, Hong Kong, and New York is that there isn't enough differentiation. There isn't enough for people to really be part of a system. So this project, for example, is all based on the idea of having similarities and differentiation. And how do one of the key elements is to make people to feel they are part of a unique complex, but also they have their specific place. I mean, this idea of the nest, we are effectively really attached to the fact that we can say that's my house with the green door, and that's my house is on the top floor of and it's a wonderful balcony. How do you bring this concept of your nest, of your house, of your apartment, of your working place back into a development that is so big? I think it's through really working out differentiating by using the same language. You want to be part of something, you want to be special, you want to have something that is yours. So empowering people throughout the design to be part of and not be shy to do it, also at the big scale of a master plan, it's what I really consider one of the great things this office has done. I'm going from very contemporary project to old projects, and the reason is that the research that is behind some of those projects, the seeds of these, it goes back to 20 years ago. Throughout paintings, throughout models, we still do a lot of models, and we still do a lot of sketches that get presented to Zhao or comes directly from Zhao. And the idea is that somehow there is a common language or a common experimentation that we are doing in the way we come up with solution or design like the Dongjimun Plaza in Seoul. What yesterday was really missing in the conversation, I think, is the centrality of the people. There was a discussion about weekend architecture and everyday architecture. I'm not a great fan of splitting those two things. I think people's lives should be always empowered. I think what us as architects, we have to do with our architecture is to make people to have to be comfortable, but always a little bit at the edge, wanted to do and discover more. I don't know, we saw the pictures of, for example, of Tokyo, this kind of cluster of signage and little trees and so on, and how that kind of very messy, disorganized space could be beautiful. No, that's what Fujimoto would say. It's still beautiful. I feel like it's part of me, it's at my scale. I think what we have to do with, we really have to push ourselves in our research for new forms of inhabitants is to find a place where people are put a little bit on the edge, where they are willing to discover more, they are willing to do one step more. Because somehow find ways of expressing our community throughout architecture, but also empowering people to want it to do more, to be on top of themselves. It's a very, very important task, not only throughout museums, that of course are quite likely to be the places, but also throughout the design of residential offices or social housing. So those projects, you know, we were also quite surprised when they told us that this building had been the most visited building in the world after the Louvre. Why is that? Why a lot of people, not only from Seoul, but from all over the world, flew to Seoul, that is not kind of famous for the art scene, to really visit this building? I truly believe that there is a part of ourselves that is always looking for the special, for something that can really bring out emotions and enlight us with power to do more. And this building, I think, it's somehow doing it quite strongly. There are other ways of looking at it. I mean, how a bridge could become an exhibition space, and instead of having only connecting A to B, how can we look at, this was the Saragossa Pavilion for an expo, how can the bridge in itself, that is an infrastructure, could become something that you explore and you visit, and how the geometry of this is helping helping you to travel to something that is not a linear connection from A to B. This multi-layered bridge with rooms that are intersecting into each other, you see some of the images at the bottom, was used during the expo as an exhibition space, and it's still there. I mean, if you go to Saragossa, please do have a walk there, because it's again putting people at the center of the conversation to enable multiple views and multiple space to embrace you. This one I'm going to be quite quick, is that one of the projects that I presented last year, and the idea again of this landscape formation for the King Abdullah Petroleum Center in Riyadh came from a through analysis of the sun condition and the meteorology, I mean the wind, predominant wind and the sun paths, and the way we shaped each one of those clusters of program, and they are mostly labs and offices in this area, but there is a gigantic mosque and there is a place where people can stay on the outside.
At the office, based really
from the fact that there are two ways to really do a sustainable architecture. One is to look at how you shape the building, like 70%, I don't know the number, I mean, Herbert would be much better than me at numbers, but the problem, the reality is that the most can be done with the way you shape your building, how you self-shape and certain spaces, how you capture the predominant wind, how you shape the roof so that the most of it can be used for solar panels. There is a lot on the geometries that we can do to make sure that the initial city is already, in terms of being green, it's already in the building. But then there is also this idea of combining it with materials. I mean, a great responsibility comes to us when pushing the industry to do not only what they know how to do and is cheap how to do, is how to push the industry to develop more on materials, on new technologies that can empower our building to truly be 21st century's building. The problem that we are facing, and this happens everywhere in Europe, in the States, or in Asia, is that the construction industry is far, far, far behind what we would like them to be. We have super small gadgets like a mobile phone that can be this big, and still, we are dealing with materials, the performance of which are really basics. So us, in every project, what we are trying to do, and of course, every one of us has a budget, has a time frame, and has a limitation, constraints on the resources. But we really try hard to work with the industry to, you know, develop and push this effectively very old way of building buildings to a way that they could be truly new and significant to the long-lasting durability, but also to the performance of a building. So again, a lot to do with the geometry of those courtyard, a lot to do with using some typical brise-au-lait solution of that region back into a completely contemporary context, like this diagram of one of the facade of the buildings. Reconnecting fragments. You might have seen now those paintings of Zaha. They look really have been published and in exhibition all over the world. What I want to show you is how this kind of representation that was a way for Zaha to express concept of reconnecting fragments of creating spaces that are unconventional, but not because we have to be unconventional, not because we have to be strange or crazy, but because we really have to look at ways, again, our presence on this planet has a mark, has our mark, and is not a copy of what was done 200 years ago. We can reuse ideas, we can relook at ideas, but effectively we are truly contemporary generation still living in a very old-fashioned environment. There are some, and I think what is nice is that this kind of research that goes back to many years ago had finally, in the last 20 years, found an expression in many buildings. This is the staircase of the Maxi Museum in Rome, and this is the Soho China, the big development in Beijing. And many projects from the fire station to, that I'm showing quickly, went through this process of, you know, studying it in drawings, in paintings, in exploded paintings. I mean, how do you reconnect the fragments of each one of the components back into something that peels off from the landscape? This project, I've been published a lot, and I think it's very interesting the way the seeds, or at the small scale of this experimentation, then happened at other students' accommodation in Germany, in many other projects of the office. Fragments can have different shapes. This is the Guangzhou Opera House and the rehearsal center, there is a big auditorium, and then there is a small rehearsal room on the side. And the idea here was to create something quite solid from the outside, something that remind of pebbles on the river. It's the actual opera house is pretty close to the river. And then, like those wonderful stones that you find time to time on beaches, you open it up and you discover a very rich, a very luxurious interiors. Again, the idea was to create a contrast, to create an unbalanced situation between a quite rigid and faceted interiors with soft core interiors. And the area in between, that is this space, the quiet space, it's actually the place where those two words, they come together and dialogue in a very, I think, powerful way. I was just talking about the museum in Rome. Again, sustainability at the urban fabric is also, of the urban environment, is also a very interesting topic. The problem is that nowadays, it looks like the only solution, if you are operating in a city center, in a historical city center like Rome, the only way you have is to somehow work with the same architectural layout of the past. There are ways of reconnecting to the urban fabric even through a completely contemporary architecture. And I think this project in Rome is really looking at it in a strong way. The geometry of each one of those tubes intersecting themselves is similar to the geometry that you can find here and there and there. And there is the intention of starting from the existing geometry and volumes, but then free it up. Why doing this kind of design? I think every project starts from the inside or from the outside, and the design has to be a combination of a brief that comes from the client, but also of the condition of the site. The idea was to create a space, not a black, a white box, a museum that could be, a simple room painted in white, and then whoever is the curator of the museum enters there and decides what to do. The idea here was to force the curator, the artist, the performance dancer to really work with a space that offers multiple vistas to start with. There is not even one room in which you cannot, be distracted somehow from something on the side. Our perception of the world is never, I mean, even if you would be, you are all looking at this slide now, but effectively you are also looking at each other, you are also looking at the space in which you are, or your mobile phone, or your notes. We are not done, human beings are not done to focus on anything for not even a fraction of a second. Our eyes are in continuous movement, and we need some sort of excitement to make us want to do more and see more. Again, it's a way of empowering people that I think this project really shows. And at the beginning, a lot of curators weren't happy because they are used to have a white box in which they can do the exhibition. It worked out now as a place where a lot of artists want to exhibit their art and want to think about something special for this building. How would they work in a space like this? It's all curved. And this, again, is an example of how architecture could create new ways of thinking, also from well-known artists or curators. See, there are a lot of interesting exhibition going on in this museum. Again, if you are in Rome, please do visit it. There are other times in which we've been lucky to have a client wanted to explore more. This is the BMW factory in Germany. And the brief was quite open, but since the beginning we wanted to give to the people working in this space some sort of more equal division of workers in the fabric and the white collar. So the idea, the whole concept, and the building is shaped in this way is that cars are here, are being assembled on trucks that travels to all of the office spaces on the bottom. White collars and workers are mixed in a BMW factory designed by Zara Lee. What does it mean? Why you need to do that? There is a lot of talks about the more you communicate, the more you encounter people, the more idea can flourish. I mean, all of the new generation of studies on, for example, on office spaces are looking at the open plan and places where people can randomly bump into each other. Why? Why is that? We want also in our office to have more exchange of idea, more what we do on WhatsApp happening at the scale of the building, where we spend 8 hours of our awake time. So designing a commission, again, this is a project that I find it beautiful for the design on the architectural point of view, but it's beautiful because it works really with a brief and with bringing people together and to do it in a different way that is more close to the way we should be doing, we should be living our office spaces and working spaces. Those are again some examples of how some of the initial design and paintings done at the time where Zara for 20 years couldn't build anything. No one wanted to give her any real project. But the office was going ahead and was still, you know, researching in shapes and forms. And some of them, after years, become buildings like the Cincinnati Museums. Again, this idea of vertical cut, of vertical communication throughout the building is one of the key points. Or we use a lot of things like pavilions or exhibitions design to inform designs like this just opened is an office in Moscow, and there is this the outside is quite simple, but the inside is very rich. There is again this idea of expressing the communication between one space and another, get people to bump into each other. There is also another way of relooking at connecting fragments, and this is, I think, very, very interesting project to a certain extent. We were asked a few years back to design an extension to an existing faculty in Oxford and Middle Eastern Studies. And the idea was to call Zara because of her background, because of what she was, but also because they wanted to get out of the existing, you know, urban fabric, express this very small building throughout a truly contemporary view. So we had a look at this project and studied. At the end, apart from the interesting shape, the decision to go for a mirror stainless steel facade to again blend more with the surrounding, blend more with nature, it became quite an interesting combination. So we are there, it's a very strong from architectural language design, yet the material allows us to be seen and not seen, be there and not there, that and again the rich interior. So the idea is to work every time you have an opportunity with a strong concept, with a strong ideas, not repeat yourself. There are many, many ways in which our practice can explore different ways of living and inhabiting the spaces. And again, connecting fragments can happen at every scale. There's an installation for the Art Biennale. Can happen throughout a series of volumes that are the same and not the same, that they really move and have this idea of flow from one part to another. The repertoire of the office, this research into ways of doing architecture doesn't stop only to landscape or fragment reconnection. It looks also at ways of working with geometry and kind of unseen geometry, like a big wave or shells. And there are a few projects, like the multi-awarded Baku in Azerbaijan Center, that wanted to have. We were lucky again. Sometimes you get the right place to explore and experiment. The city, it's really poor. It really needed a landmark in terms of finding a focus point for a big area of kind of Russian poor social housing. And we were lucky because we had the possibility here, with a big budget, sometimes you have it, sometimes you don't, to express a new way of seeing an Acropolis, a space where people will meet and will encounter. The space is folding over itself, it's creating this, again, multiple vistas and multiple shapes. They are part of this research into collaboration, into being part of the bigger system. Chanel Pavilion or the extension of the Serpentine Galleries are again looking at materials or composition, the new and old brought together into one unique space. This is in London. Again, if you stop by, I would strongly recommend. Sometimes the office get criticized for intervention like this, because there is still a big part of our academia or of architect that thinks that there isn't much to do with architecture. Architecture has to be functional. Architecture has to be only what is needed for us to live, work, and sleep. And I don't think it's only that. I think the expression of architecture has to look at us as human, of our willingness to somehow be present with strong ideas. We shouldn't be limited in a box. No one should be ever live in a box in a box. And again, the project that Fujimoto was showing yesterday, I found it fantastic because it was really complex from a human perception, the box in a box house. But at the same time, you work with very simple geometry, again, budget, and again, condition of the plot had forced or had allowed him to come up with a very, very interesting three-dimensional space. I have to speed up a little bit, but again, this happens at different scale, the research on how to build, and touches again on our research into materials for facade, into new technology of how to build projects. And this doesn't happen also only in China, in Russia, but also in southern Italy. This terminal was designed in 2000 and opened 2 months ago. And it's a very small building, and we had to fight with the city, with corruption, with a lot of problems, and it took 16 years, though it's still valid. So the durability of a project when the design has a strong concept, has a strong ideas, I think it's not going to be only for 2 years. It will last in time. We have to believe in ourselves and the fact that if you have an idea and strong ideas, the links to the program and to the place, that will last for a very long time. Working with voids, there have been a lot of projects that explore the concept of breaking the space throughout, carving out mass. So more than designing the walls and the floor, is designing the voids. The voids as something that is not there because it's air, it's whatever, sky, or it's this internal space here. But in reality, it's very strong presence. This is a penthouse in Beijing, and it's being built, and it goes back to, again, an exhibition done in Germany many years ago where You know, this kind of geometry were almost impossible for the manufacturer to be produced. Now you would think, okay, yeah, see three, five axis CNC machine and it's done. At the time, we had to really experiment with the actual factory producing it because there wasn't anything like that. And it became a very interesting exhibition, so these multiple views into the space, but also a way of getting to bigger project. This is again the Soho Beijing, where the idea is to, throughout those open courtyard that are quite simple,
where people can
meet,
they find
an internal plaza, they feel in a space, but at the same time, they are allowed and empowered to circulate and to, they are willing to go around and see more. This is one of the opening. Again, design of hotel in Abu Dhabi. We worked with this idea. The client wanted a lot of rooms, in a square plot, and there was limitation on height. There was limitation of how we can really reach the request brief throughout and give though enough views out for the building. So we work with this basic cube geometry and carve it out to a point that every room then has a view out. And this experiment has been done in office spaces. The space that is usually taken by a core, it's voided out with lifts coming up and down, those are lifts, and it's given back to the use and the fruition for people. And this building is now under construction. It's going to be the highest atrium in the world once built. So again, the concept of bringing people that are working back to the center, to the core of the building fabric in itself. A project I've been working now for more than 3 years. It's an hotel in Macau. Again, the request was for a very high number of rooms, and the plot in which we were confined was very small. And all of this was already built. So again, how do you deal with the site condition, so extreme site condition, and still give enough view for every rooms? We work out a geometry that carving out a lot of voids in the inner space and freeing up a very tall, 40 meters tall atrium space could eventually gives you the required amount of rooms and square meters by the client, but it creates a very multi-layered views as you move up into the lift through all of the voids. So the lifts are captured, they move up and down in the straightforward core, and they pass through every single of those voids. Under construction should be open in 2 years' time, some samples of the work that we are doing. And it goes back to very small research into tables, seatings, the idea of water into this table. I think it's very, very high intuition by the office. Working with manufacturer, this is plexiglass, but to the maximum expression. I just wanted to give you an example of the work of the office when looking at voids done with furnitures as well. I would like to close, and I hope it works. Otherwise, it would be always possible with a video tribute done by very well-known architects around the world to Zaha herself. It's difficult for me that been knowing her personally, but also in the office, to really convey the strength and the energy she giving all of us, not just me working there, but all of you, and the opening of possibilities that she gave us as architects. The office is strong, we're gonna go ahead. I mean, we are a very, very close team of architects that will go ahead, starting from what Zaha has taught us, but looking at ways of, you know, doing more and better. This is what she would wanted.
Zaha was a genius. She was doing work that nobody else conceived of, never mind figured out how to build.
Zaha was a pioneer, and she was a star in the firmament of ideas and of poetry. And once a star goes out, there is really no one to replace it. She was unique.
There are very few people in the world who are known by one name. And, you know, anywhere in the world you can talk about Zaha.
Zaha's historical significance, I think, is, if anything, has been underestimated. She's been a monumental innovator, radically expanding the degrees of freedom one has as a composer in space.
Who knows what extraordinary creative things might have come out of that imagination if it had another one or two decades to keep producing things.
While I was at the AA, there was this sense that this was somebody who was going to be a great architect. And the AA was this just hotbed of radical thinking. And yet she was the one who, I think, most successfully exported those ideas and developed it into a language that could then be kind of understood.
I started studying architecture in 1993, and of course, like, stumbled upon Zaha's paintings. What she managed to do, which is so amazing, is to actually take this entire universe that seemed impossible and unbuildable, and completely sort of changing our understanding of what's fantasy and what's reality.
When you're an artist or an architect, you need immense courage, you know, and Zaha had this immense courage and radiating immense courage, and I think that was infectious to many, many young people.
She has certainly sculpted up a way through society and architecture, which is unique. Which is so great, I cannot, that words are not sufficient.
What you hear about Zaha and what she was actually like are two very different things. She was very tender about the people that mattered to her.
She also had a temper sometimes in the work, but it came out of an intense will to excellence and a certain degree of insecurity whether what we had at any time was good enough, which kind of fueled this drive to do more.
She was so full of energy, she was so full of ideas.
How do you sum Zaha up? A great architect and a great person, a very special person.
The very essence of Zaha was a real romantic, very sensitive, but a warrior too. And that's how I like to remember her.